This is the day the Lord has made. I watched last Sunday's service with Peggy here leading. We had a wonderful time at Chautauqua, but I understand that like she yelled at you for not being energetic enough the first time around with "This is the day the Lord has made." You did fine this morning. There will be no repercussions. We start the day with words. We start the day quoting scripture, the 118th Psalm. We start the day with chimes. We start the day by creating our response to what God has made possible. The creator of the universe has set aside this place, this space, this time for us to be together. It is very important to remember that we don't come here to find God. God is found in so many places. God is found in every place, even in the darkness of humans' inhumanity to other humans. God is found here. We come to find each other finding God in the midst of that darkness, but also in the midst of great joy. If you brought with you a joy or concern that you would like to have be a part of our prayers, a few ways you can make that happen. If you are out there someplace and you are enjoying us online, then you can text to the phone number online. You can text your joy or concern to me. You can do that from here as well. If you want to fill out a yellow card, Nancy Fleshour will wander up and down the aisles and she will pick up the yellow cards, and your joy, your concern becomes a part of our prayers. Just before we go into prayer, if something comes to you and you want to raise your hand, I'll figure out a way to make sure that your joy, your concern becomes part of our prayers. And that's another way of saying that to this congregation, prayer is very important. There are lots of announcements in your bulletin. I ask that you pay special attention to them. There is a annual YCMC meeting following worship, open meeting. If you would like to come, come and speak your piece as we look forward to re-energizing our church school program that begins on Rally Day. And we're looking toward making some pretty wonderful special music available on Rally Day. That speaks to a youthful energy. Enough said.
Good morning. Hi, my name is, as you know, Joya. Please raise your hand if you love taking home Panera Bread. Well, if you raise your hand, we need your help. The deacons are in need of gallon Ziploc storage bags to store the bread properly. Thank you.
That was magnificently succinct. I think we've had more than enough announcements, so let us spend a moment in silent prayer, preparing our hearts, our minds, our souls for the rest of worship as we listen to Lori with an organ meditation this morning. Let us join together in being called to worship. What does this worship service need? Who shall come to this worship service? An announcement I forgot to make, or want to make sure gets made, is today we celebrate summer communion. We always make sure there's a time in the middle of summer where we come together at the Lord's table. We are invited by name. It is an open table, so everyone who is here this morning is welcome to participate. If we say there is nothing in our lives that separates us, one from each other and each other from our God, then we deceive ourselves. We deceive ourselves from getting what God wants for most all God's children and what God wants for all of us. Health, healing, wholeness, and a sense of being forgiven, so that we can go forth new people and we can forgive those who have sinned against us. Let us come together in prayer. We confess, O God, how often it is true of us that when difficult times come, we are trapped in the little worlds of our own making. We never look up to see the signs of hope you hold for us. Restore to us, we pray, the vision of new life with new beginnings, the promise of your grace and the strength of your love. Through Jesus Christ, Lord of life and love. Amen. And this is the gospel good news. God welcomes us. God receives us. Not as we should be or as we want to be, but exactly however it is we have arrived. This is the good news of a risen Christ. Listen, give thanks, and live. Amen.
Let us pray. God of mercy, you promised never to break your covenant with us. Amid all the changing words of our generation, speak your eternal word that does not change. Then may we respond to your gracious promises with faithful and obedient lives. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Today's Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 32. Verses 22 to 31, and I'll start with a short introduction. To make sense of this story of undeserved blessings, we should consider it in the context of Jacob's extended journey from Canaan to Syria and back. Very often, stories of journeys, biblical or otherwise, are also stories about character transformation. The story in Genesis 32 finds Jacob homeward bound after 20 years away, with his past threatening to catch up with him. Faced with the prospect of meeting up with his brother, who may yet wish revenge, Jacob finds himself at a turning point. He can face up to what waits for him, or he can do what he has done in the past, turn tail and run. On Jacob's return home, God takes advantage of a brief moment of solitude, a moment when Jacob is most exposed and vulnerable. But this time, God comes posing as a dark and disguised threat and not as a protector. Whatever the reason for the attack, Jacob's response is to stand his ground and face his attacker. Jacob's reaction is a departure from the usual. Instead of cunning evasion, he fights openly and persistently to get what he most wants. A blessing. Listen to God's word. The same night he got up and took his two wives, his two maids, and his 11 children and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and likewise everything that he had. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he did not prevail against Jacob, he struck him on the hip socket, and Jacob's hip was out of joint as he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the day is breaking." But Jacob said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." Then the man said, "You shall no longer be called Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with humans, and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And there he blessed him. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "For I have seen God face to face, yet my life is preserved." The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping because of his hip. This is the word of the Lord.
The Christian scriptures for this morning, I read from Matthew's gospel. We've been moving our way through the 13th and 14th chapters of Matthew's gospel. I read from the 14th chapter, beginning at the 13th verse. When Jesus got the news, he slipped away by boat to an out-of-the-way place by himself. But unsuccessfully, someone saw him, and the word got around. Soon a lot of people from nearby villages walked around the lake to where he was. When he saw them coming, he was overcome with pity and healed their sick. Toward evening, the disciples approached him. "We're out in the country, and it's getting late. Dismiss the people so they can go to the villages and get some supper." But Jesus said, "There is no need to dismiss them. You give them supper. All we have are 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they said. Jesus said, "Bring them here." Then he had the people sit on the grass. He took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, lifted his face to heaven in prayer, blessed, broke, and gave the bread to the disciples. The disciples then gave the food to the congregation. And they all ate their fill. They gathered 12 baskets of leftovers. About 5,000 were fed. This is the word of the Lord. Thank you. sometimes. Sometimes I put on this hat. I put on this hat, and you know how it works. There are children up front here. Often when I put the hat on, I ask them to pretend, I ask you to pretend, and I become someone from Scripture for a little bit. Today, it's a little different. I'm not going to become someone from the Bible, but I'm going to become an avid pew sitter. Somebody who reads the Bible, somebody who loves coming to church. I'm going to become two such people, and I'm going to talk about how they feel about this morning's passage. Please pretend along with me. I'm a practical man, and I love to know how things work because I love to solve problems. And if you know how something works, you can solve the problem. You can rely on reliable things like math and science, the knowledge we have that has taken us very far. So I like to know what's going on. And I like things to be reasonable, and I like things to be sane, and I like things to be orderly, and I like to know how things work. Well, I've always been bothered by this morning's passage. Because all of a sudden, a few fish and some bread is enough to feed 5,000 people. How does that work? Is it just simply hocus pocus? Is it magic? Is it something that we can recreate so that lots of people get fed? So the passage bothers me just because it seems to rely on stuff that I don't have access to. I can't do that. Then one day, I read an article. And the article said that, well, there probably was enough food to go around in the little pilgrimage baskets that every family would have had with them. People traveling around would have had little baskets with some food in it, just in case. So the real point of the story, and I like this part, is that there was no magic, there was no hocus pocus, there was no something out of nothing. Instead, people were encouraged to see, oh, he's sharing what he has, I'll share what I have. And all of a sudden they discovered amongst the folks who had gathered, if they were just willing to share, well, everybody got fed. I like that. I like those kind of arguments that allow us to stay in a reasonable and rational place as we try to be faithful followers of Jesus Christ. I'm not a lazy man, but I don't want to have to work any harder than I need to. What an incredible story. People are following Jesus. People are saying, this guy is saying stuff that people haven't said in a long, long time. And this guy is saying things in such a way that he has authority. Authority over evil spirits. Authority over the economy. He's making sure that people get fed. And so the people come from far and near to have their sick folk healed. So he attempts to get away. And I know that that sometimes just doesn't work. You know, you think you're going to have a few minutes to yourself. The doorbell rings. The phone goes off. Jesus went to have a few moments by himself. Someone saw, oh, he's going that way. So everybody made their way around, and they found him. And he took pity on them, and he healed their sick. Now, in the story, it says that the disciples, practical folk, said, look, you got to send him away because we got enough for us, but we don't have enough for all of them. And Jesus said, no, you do. You're going to give them supper. And then he blesses the bread, and he blesses the fish, and he gives them back to the disciples. And the disciples hand it all out, and there's more than enough to go around. I don't need to know how it happened. I just know it happened. I don't need to know how God did it working through Jesus Christ. I just know there were a lot of hungry people, and through the power of the Holy Spirit, through the power of God, through the power of the Son, they got what they needed. So to fuss about trying to make it rational or reasonable, I like to watch Murder, She Wrote. Some of you may know what that is. It's a mystery, but what's wonderful about Murder, She Wrote is at the end of the mystery, at the end of the hour, you are going to know who did it. They're going to say, yes, I did it, and I'd do it again if I had a chance. But I know that God is different than that. God is a mystery that cannot be solved. So the fussing about how to understand the story in a way that's reasonable and rational, to me, is a waste of time, talent, and treasure. It happened. What a wonderful thing. God, in that moment, to those people, gave them everything they needed. That's enough from me. So if I were mean, when you came forward for communion later, I would have you come up and go by the communion table and stand by the stool that makes the most sense for you. So which person do you have the most in common with here? The person who is grateful for a way to understand the story and still hold on to science and reason and those kind of things. Or the person who says, don't waste your time. Live in and out of the mystery of God. C.S. Lewis, in a book called God in the Docks, he proposes an idea, and the idea is we can figure out whether prayer really works. What we do is we get a bunch of faithful people together, and we pick a hospital. And all those faithful people pray for the people in that hospital. And then we pick another hospital. And we say no one of those faithful people is to pray for anybody in that hospital. They're just supposed to pray for the people in the hospital that was chosen for them. So one hospital gets all the prayers, and the other hospital gets none of the prayers, and then we just count as to where the most healing was. And people are listening going, wow, how come no one's thought of that before? We could put together experiments that would prove the power of prayer. And then we find out that C.S. Lewis was just messing with us, because he says, how can you in good faith pray for one group of people and then intentionally not pray for another group of people? It does not work. It's kind of like that this morning. Is this person right? Is this person right? Well, it's a conversation where we're in trouble just for even having asked the question. Robert McAfee Brown talks about in the 60s, there was a lot of arguing over whether you should feed someone first who is needy or whether you should save them first. Do you save them first and worry about their internal existence, or do you feed them first and worry about their belly? And then after their belly is full, talk to them about a relationship, a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, or do you start in that place and say, do you know Jesus? Worry about their eternal self, and then later worry about their physical body. He said, you know, sometimes they argue back and forth, and the compromise seems to be, okay, we need to both feed them and save their souls. But he, like C.S. Lewis, says, you're in trouble when you just even ask the question, whether you feed them first and save them, and then save them or feed them. because you can't really love someone unless you love their whole being, unless you love them heart, body, mind, and soul. So again, we're in a place where trying to figure out who's right and who's wrong, who's got the right logic and who's got the wrong logic, doesn't serve us well. This morning's passage, it's actually pretty simple. Dedicate what you have to God, and incredible things start to happen. Doesn't matter whether it's reasonable or rational, or whether it's living in and out of an unsolvable mystery. Our job is simple. Look at what we have. Go to the cupboard, go to the pantry. The physical cupboard, the physical pantry, the emotional and spiritual cupboard and pantry in our lives. Go to them, open the doors, look and see what we have, dedicate the gap to God, give it to God. God will bless it, God will pray over it, God will do whatever God wants, and all of a sudden we will find ourselves in the midst of the miraculous, in the midst of the problem being solved. So quite simply, we are called to take stock of what we have. Is it 5 loaves and 2 fishes? Who knows? We are called to take stock of what we have and give it over to God. And when we do that, miraculous things happen where they need to happen most. Amen. Okay. Dear Stephen, once again you've blown it. She actually didn't write that. Dear Stephen, sermon hymn is wrong in the bulletin. You satisfy the hungry hearts is 521, not 440. 5 loaves, 2 fishes. The table of the Lord. You might look at this table as the moment where Jesus takes what has been given to him and breaks it and blesses it and lifts it up to God. This is the Lord's table. And the little bit of biscuit bread that you will have this morning and the little bit of grape juice that you will have this morning are God's gifts to us. So that having been given everything we need, we can take stock and then we can dedicate all the leftovers to those who need it most. It says in Scripture, people will come from east and west and from north and south to sit at table in the kingdom of our Lord. And our Savior invites all those who believe. And to my way of thinking, that means all those who struggle with what it means to believe. Whether you're sitting over here or you're sitting over here, all those who struggle with what it means to live a faithful life, which is all of us. We are all invited by name to share in the feast that has been prepared for us. Our risen Lord was at table with his disciples. And after giving thanks, he broke it. He gave it to them. Their eyes were opened. They recognized who he was. Let us pray. Loving God, we pray perhaps one of the bravest prayers of all. Open our eyes. Open our eyes that we might see. It's scary because we might see things we don't want to see. We might begin to know that we are a part of things that we don't want to be a part of, because with our eyes wide open to the choices that we are making, well, it could set us back quite a bit. But because we trust in you, and because we know that you will not send us places that it is impossible to return from, we ask that you open our eyes so that we might see you, so that we might know you, so that we can give thanks for you. Open our eyes to the rising sun every morning and the setting sun every evening. Open our eyes as we close them to the peace of the nighttime and sleep. Open our eyes as we see the joy that you have given us along the way. Open our eyes as we grieve when there is loss in our lives, as we walk alongside those who are grieving. Open our eyes and help us know that with open eyes, you will be with us. You will make sure that we do not stumble or fall. Open our eyes so that we truly might give thanks for a lived Christ, a preacher, teacher, healer, for a crucified Christ, for a risen Christ. Open our eyes that we might know the Creator. Open our eyes that we might know the Redeemer. And open our eyes, Lord, that we might know the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit that enters into our lives and directs us to go places we never thought we could go, but we go. And with the power of the Holy Spirit, we make a difference. With the power of our dedicated resources, we make a difference. And the miraculous occurs in your name. Make your presence felt as we are invited by name. It doesn't look like much of a feast, but it is. It's exactly what we need. It is in Christ's name we pray. Amen. On the night that he was arrested, I'm going to invite the servers to come forward now. Okay. Are you looking for this? Now, Karen, stay right there. Okay. On the night that he was arrested, Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it. He said, "This is my body. It is broken for you. Take, eat, all of you." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He said, "This cup, it is a new covenant. It is a new promise. It is sealed in my sacrifice." Every time we eat of this loaf and we drink of this cup, we proclaim the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ until he comes again. In a moment, I invite you to come forward. Now, we've started doing this kind of in the midst of the pandemic, and we have stayed with it. It's intention, kind of. You come forward, and you will hear the bread of life, the cup of salvation. And it's all in one convenient little package. And then you take it back. And then I will go through the words you need to hear as you first open the bottom and take out that little morsel of bread, and we will partake together. And then you turn it over, and very carefully, so that you don't get grape juice on your Sunday finery, you will open the cup, and we will share in the cup of salvation together. Excuse me. And this is what Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst." And then Jesus said, "I am the vine. You folks, you are the branches. Branches can produce good fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches. But cut off from me, branches cut off from the vine, produce no fruit. Branches cut off from the vine can do nothing at all. Loving God, thanks for the invitation. Loving God, thanks for making sure that we have what we need to serve, to offer others what it is that we might be taking for granted, or receive from others what it is that we desperately need in our lives. From the heart, from the body, from the mind, from the soul. We give thanks this day that we are a people well fed. It is in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Prayers of the people. Where is the Deerhurst Presbyterian Church in prayer this morning? There is a prayer list, excuse me, on the back of your bulletin or on the screen in front of you or for you at home. And it tells us who we're praying for today and this week. And then it tells us who we are praying for in regard to the problems of the world. And it tells us who we might continue to keep in prayer. If you know of anybody on the prayers for continued healing that might be removed, not as a means of saying, oh, we're done with them, but rather a celebration that their life has returned to what may be a new normal for them, but a celebration that they now have a new sense of life and hope. So I'm going to read for you the prayers of the week. I'm going to add the yellow cards, the ones that came to me on the phone, and then I'm going to ask that you take your bulletin home with you and you keep all these people before God in prayer throughout the week. We pray for the Reverend Kinzer Pointer and family at the death of his son. That comes from Kara. We pray for Don Jones, and that comes from Carla Gibbons. And all of those folks, the people in that pew right there, are all at a Mary Kay convention in Dallas. So we'll keep them in our thoughts and prayers. Traveling mercy for the Kiter clan on the way from Cleveland. Bob and Linda and Eugene Carlisle traveled from California to Cleveland. And they had a big family reunion yesterday. Did I mention Amy? I put her on the bus to Cleveland a few days ago. And she met and was a part of all that, and now all four of them are coming back here to Buffalo for a week. So we keep them in prayers. Peggy Hancock, Joe's sister, healing for major cancer surgery. The Ziegler Smith clan as they return home to Buffalo with broken hearts that are still in need of mending. We keep Bruce Don in our prayers, and he is done with his treatments. But I guess they have to wait a little bit and then do all those tests to see if what they needed to do got done. Andy DeSantis asks that we pray for Leon. Jeanette asks that we pray for Louie. And as we pray for Louie, we can sneak in a prayer for Jeanette at the same time. And Jim Moore, more tests this week to find out what is next in regard to him searching for a chance to feel better. We add Uncle Al, who is in hospice, and his daughter Betty during this difficult time. That comes from Jan and Julie. Ilana's grandmother, Gigi, diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. Wow, we keep them in prayers. Linda Miller, upcoming hip surgery, that comes from Bob Patterson. Kevin Kilgallen, recovering from a stroke, my sister Sue trying to take care of him. And that comes from Bob Patterson. And Gretchen Silbert asks, requesting prayers for me as I recover slowly from COVID. Thank you, Gretchen Silbert. Let us give thanks for Heather, because she played magnificently this morning. Let us give thanks for elders and deacons who step up and make sure that we get what we need, whether it's talking about Christian education and curriculum and teaching our youngest, or whether it's making sure that the resources are there to keep our courtyard food cupboard pantry up and going, or whether it's making sure that not only are people physically fed, but they are spiritually fed as well. Let us come together in prayer. Loving God, for sounds of life we give thanks. We hear the cars coming and going outside the windows that need to be open on a warm day. Signs of life. We hear people chatting before and after worship, talking about what's going on in their lives, taking care of each other with words, taking care of each other with no words, just listening. Lord, we give thanks for signs of life. A little bit of bread, a little bit of grape juice. And we not only know who we are, we know whose we are. We are yours. You have invited us to be a part of mystery and a part of problem solving and a part of dedicating resources so that the miraculous might happen. Make your presence felt this day. We pray for the grieving. Make your presence felt this day. We pray for the healing who haven't quite been able to fully embrace feeling fully healed. And we pray for those who are full of your spirit, who are full of your life, who are full of your joy, because they're on the other side of something. Make your presence with them, so that their joy might be shared and not diminished. We pray all this in Christ's name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sin, as we forgive those who sin against us. Us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If asking God to open our eyes that we might see is difficult, what I'm going to ask you to do next should be fun. You can close your eyes or you can keep your eyes wide open. But as you listen to Lori, think about all that you have. Think about all that you are thankful for. Think about all the things that bring joy into your life. Those are the things that God gives us, that God's fingerprints are all over these things. I truly believe God doesn't do hurricanes or tornadoes. God doesn't do horrible things in the name of making everybody behave. But God does do what brings us joy. So let us spend a moment giving thanks for all that God has done for us and all that God can do in and through us.
God of life, Savior of the poor, receive with this money gratitude for your goodness, penitence for our pride, and dedication to your service. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Eyes wide open, head held high, a prayer we often turn inward, we close our eyes, we fold our hands. This is a blessing that you receive so that you can leave here and you can go take stock of whatever is in your spiritual, emotional, physical pantry and you can dedicate it to God. And then you can go out into the world and serve. The love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the fellowship, communion, and support of the Holy Spirit, let it be ours this day, every day, now and forevermore. Amen.